The second application that we will talk about is titled jury decisions. What do I mean by jury decisions? So what is a jury? So jury or jurors are citizens who in court decides on convictions of cases. So in many countries, unlike in India, instead of the judge deciding the verdict, the verdict is decided by citizens, a group of citizens who are selected randomly for each case and chosen to be the jury members. Okay, so the jury decides the verdict. So the jury attends the court sessions. They get paid to do that. So for example, in US, you know, if you're an American citizen, one day you may get a mail from the court saying that you have to appear in the court as a jury member. And there are fines for not appearing on court mandated dates. If you are working, you can actually get a time off to appear in court to perform this duty, because appearing as a jury member in courts is considered a constitutional duty of all citizens in the US. So you attend the jury and you attend the court sessions of a given case, and then all the evidence and the arguments of the lawyers, you listen to them, and then you deliberate among yourselves. All the jury members, all the jurors deliberate among themselves, and then they come up with a verdict, okay, which is then announced publicly, okay, to the court. This kind of court system is present in some countries, but the concept of a jury deciding on the outcome is prevalent in many contexts, right? So say film awards are given by a set of jurors. So the jury decides after watching all the films, which is the sort of best film, best director, etc. Say the Infosys prize given out every year is also decided by jury. If you go to the Infosys prize website, for each discipline you will find a set of jurors who constitute the jury for each year, who decide on the prize, who gets the prize. Okay, so this concept of a jury's making a decision on a very important outcome is prevalent in many contexts, and not just in terms of court systems, but we will sort of have the court system in our mind when we model this. This is a strategic context, because information available to each jury member may be different across the members. And so when they vote within a committee, within the jury, they may have to consider what is the voting strategy of the other jury members and vote accordingly. Okay, so you may have preferences defined over various outcomes. So in the court setting, you may have different preferences. You may get different payoffs depending on whether a person is gets convicted, even though he is actually innocent, versus in the context when he is actually guilty, right? So and these voting outcomes may not just, you know, would not just depend on your voting decision, but the voting decision of all the other jury members, right? So when you vote based on the information that you have, you may have to worry about how the other jury members are voting, right? So your strategy may be contingent on other strategy, and it's also a game of incomplete information, because here you may not be aware of all the information that is available to the other jury members. You know, maybe different juries in a court proceedings may pay attention to different parts of the arguments, may remember or may pay more attention to certain subset of documents, etc., as submitted as evidence. And so the pool of information based on which the an individual jury member is deciding his or her voting decision is private information, is only known to him or her, right? And you obviously know what information that you are basing your decision on, but you don't know what the others are doing. So that way it becomes a game of incomplete information, right? So we'll model it that way. So to simplify in this model of jury decisions, we'll say that there are two jurors, one and two, they are interested in a case where the defendant, defendant can be either guilty, we'll denote guilty by small g, or innocent. Will denote innocent by small I. Okay. So the defendant can be either guilty or innocent. To begin with, we assume that both jurors believe that the defendant is guilty or innocent with probability half, right? So both jurors believe that the defendant is guilty with probability half and innocent with probability half. Okay. Now, during the court proceedings, during the document, during the arguments provided by the lawyers and the documents submitted by the lawyers, both sides, certain information gets revealed to the jurors. However, even though both jurors are attending the same set of arguments, same set of course proceedings, different jurors pay attention to various parts of the arguments and documents. They don't have the capacity to absorb everything, right? So that's the assumption. And so basically they each get a separate signal about whether the defendant is guilty or innocent. Okay, and however, the signal depends on whether the person is actually guilty or innocent, right? So we say that each juror gets a signal capital G or capital I during the court proceedings. The signal is capital G with probability 3/4 and I with probability 1/4 when defendant is guilty. So what is the signal? The signal is either capital G or capital I. It's a probabilistic signal. It's a noisy signal. And if the defendant is guilty, then each juror independently gets signal capital G with probability 3/4. So there's, if the defendant is actually guilty, then from the arguments and the set of documents, there is 3/4 chance that one juror will get signal that he is indeed guilty. So capital G refers to the signal that the person is guilty. And capital I refers to the signal that that the defendant may be innocent. And so if the defendant is actually guilty, there is 75% chance that a particular one juror will get signal capital G. Okay. But it's, the probability is not 1-0, right? So that's the noise in the system, right? So if they were listening to all the arguments, they probably would have come to a more certain conclusion, but they don't have the capacity to pay attention to everything, and that's sort of, that introduces noise. And secondly, each juror gets independent signal. So it's possible that I get signal capital G as juror 1 and you, juror 2, get capital signal capital I. Even though the chance is less, that there is only 25% chance that you will get a signal I, but still you can get it. Your signal is different from my signal. We get independent signals, and that's because of our limited capacity to pay attention to everything. So you may pay attention to a separate set of documents and separate set of court proceedings than I am. So it is possible that even though a lot of the documents show that the person is guilty, you don't pay as much attention to all the documents there, and you pay attention to all the sort of rebuttal documents and arguments, and that sort of makes you get signal capital I, right? Even though it's less likely, but it's still possible. So the jurors 1 and 2 get separate signals. So instead of saying signal S, I should maybe write S1 and S2, okay, instead of writing S. So basically this says that S1 and S2 independently can be capital G and capital I. So there are two signals, one for each juror, and they occur with this probability when the defendant is guilty. I haven't said what is the probability of G and I when the defendant is innocent, so that's coming, okay? But this is the signal structure when the defendant is guilty for each juror. Similarly, S1 and S2 is G with probability 1/4 and I with probability 3/4 when defendant is innocent. Okay, so if the defendant is actually innocent, then now the probability is flipped. So now each juror gets a signal I with 75% chance, but then they may also get a signal G with probability 1/4. Okay, and again each juror gets separate signals. It's possible that different jurors get different signal. It's possible that they can both get the same signal. It's also possible that they both get same signal of the wrong kind, right? So even if the defendant is innocent, it is possible, it has positive probability that both parties, both jurors get signal capital G, okay? Even though it's, the probability will be very less, but it's again possible, okay? So now, suppose the person is guilty. Suppose the defendant is guilty. What is the probability that that both jurors get signal G? Okay. So what is the probability that both jurors get signal G, given the person is actually guilty? Okay. What is the probability that juror number 1 will get signal capital G? It's 3/4, right? What is the probability that juror number 2 will get signal capital G? It's also probability 3/4. And these are independents, right? The signals are independently drawn. So that's important. So then the probability that both get signal G, capital G, is 3/4 times 3/4. So this is 9 by 16. Okay. What is the probability of, again, both getting signal GG when the person is actually innocent? So both individuals get the wrong signals when the person is actually innocent. So what is the probability that juror 1 will get signal capital G when the person is innocent? We see it's 1/4, right? So it's 1/4. The same is true for the second juror. So it's 1/4 times 1/4. So both, because we want to find out both jurors get the same signal, so we have to multiply the probability because they're independent events. Okay, that gives you probability 1/6. So you see that if the person is guilty, then both jurors getting capital G signal is 9 times as likely as both getting capital G signal under the condition that the person is actually innocent, right? So it's 9 by 16 as opposed to 1 by 16, right? So when the person is actually innocent, it's much less likely that both will get signal capital G, okay? Now, but we don't know, you know, jurors don't know whether the person is guilty or innocent. So these probabilities are conditioning on something that the jurors don't know. Jurors are interested in the other way around. So given that jurors get signals of particular kind, what is the probability that the defendant is guilty or innocent? That's the computation that the jurors will be able to do, right? So these probabilities are not particularly useful for jurors, because jurors don't know whether the person is innocent or guilty, correct? So you have to flip, and that's where we have to use Bayes rule, okay? So and now you see why the equilibrium concept is called Bayes-Nash equilibrium, because in some places we actually have to compute our probabilities using Bayes rule. So suppose both jurors get signal G, okay? Suppose, you know, we are not, you know, I have obviously said that each juror gets to see his or her own signal. He doesn't know what the other juror's signal is, but we will come to that information problem later. We want to find out what is the probability, the flipped probability. What is the probability that the defendant is actually guilty, given that both jurors get signal GG? Okay, what is this probability? So suppose jurors could see each other's signal, and they both see that they've both gotten capital G signal. How would they update their belief? So remember that to begin with, each juror believes, so both jurors believe that the defendant is guilty with probability half and innocent with probability half, right? Now that they get this signal after the court proceedings, they get these signals GG, what is now their updated belief that he is guilty? Okay, it should ideally be greater than half, right? Because without any information, they thought the person is guilty with probability half. Now both jurors get signal G. So then, given that they are more likely to get signal G when the person is guilty, then they should increase the probability. But by how much they should increase? For that, we need to compute this probability and use Bayes rule. So basically, this probability using Bayes rule is given by probability of GG, capital G, given the person is guilty, times that the probability that he is guilty, divided by probability of getting 2 G signals. Okay, this is from Bayes rule. So probability of A given B is probability of B given A times probability of A divided by probability of B. Okay, so that's from Bayes rule. Okay, what is probability of getting two G signals? Probability of getting two G signals is, so you can get two G signals when the person is guilty. So this is the probability of getting two signals when the person is guilty, and you can also get two capital G signals when the person is innocent, and this is the probability that the person is innocent, right? So this is the total probability of getting two G signals. You don't know whether the person is guilty or innocent. You see two G signals, but then you can compute what is the likelihood of getting that. Okay, and you can get that when the person is guilty, and you can also get that when the person is innocent. So we use their constant respective probabilities to compute this. We have already computed this object, so this is 9/16. What is the probability of the person is guilty? Here we are using the initial belief half. We have computed this probability, this is 1/16, and probability of innocent is also half, so that gives you 10/32 or 5/16. Okay, so then now we can compute the Bayes rule thing. What is the probability that the defendant is guilty given the event that both jurors get signal capital G? In the numerator I have 9/16 times probability of being guilty, which is half, divided by 5/16. This is 9/10. Notice how high the probability is. There is 90% chance that the probability that the defendant is guilty when both jurors get signal capital G. Okay. Similarly, you can compute what is the probability of the person is guilty when one juror gets signal I, the other juror gets signal G. Okay. This is the probability again by using Bayes rule. It will be IG given the person is guilty times probability of being guilty divided by probability of getting signal IG generally. If you calculate this computation, this you should do at home, you would get its half. Notice there is no updating of belief. Belief is not updated. What do I mean by that? The probability that the person is guilty was half to begin with, without any information. After you go through the court proceedings, one juror gets signal I, the other juror gets signal G. If they could see each other's signal, they would still believe that the person is guilty with half. So basically my G signal cancels your I signal in some sense, in this specific example. It need not happen, but in this example they cancel each other, so we don't change our belief. So we continue to believe that their probability is half, that they're guilty with probability half. Okay. In the next video, I will now talk about equilibrium strategies.